Hallelujah. Good morning, church. Good to see you all on this fine Sunday. Welcome to Holland First Assembly. We're so excited that you could join us this morning. We want to welcome our online congregation as well. Aren't you thankful for Jesus this morning? I know we celebrated Good Friday, Resurrection Sunday last week, but I'm so thankful that Jesus is an everyday Jesus, amen? Come on, his mercies are new every morning. He is faithful. Great is his faithfulness. So we've come together just to lift up his name, to give him glory and honor and praise. So Jesus, you are worthy. We declare it even now, you are worthy, Lord. We humble our hearts before you. We say, have your way in this place, Lord. Move today. Holy Spirit, fall on us, rest on us today. In your name we pray. Hallelujah. Sometimes you gotta dance through the darkness, sing through the fire, praise till it don't make sense. Sometimes you gotta stare down the giant, worship from the lion's den. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder that he's gonna get you there. Sometimes you gotta welcome the wonder, wait for the answer, worship with your hands in the air. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give praise, give praise in the highest. Praise, give praise, give praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all I praise. Sometimes you gotta praise in the prison, cry out to heaven, shout it till the doors swing wide. Sometimes you gotta stand on your shackles, brave in the battle, worship with your hands held high. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give praise, give praise in the highest. Praise, give praise, give praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all our praise. Give praise. Give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all our praise. Come on, he's worthy, amen. He's faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why. I'll praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath. I'll praise you anywhere. Faithful all my life, blessings day and night, countless reasons why. I'll praise you anywhere. Every promise kept, goodness every step, each and every breath. I'll praise you anywhere. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. He is worthy. Yes, he is worthy of all our praise. Give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Praise, give him praise, give him praise in the highest. Worthy, amen. Worthy is your name, Lord. narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on it. It's a narrow road, the mercy's wide, 'cause you're good on your promise. I take you at your word. You said it, I'll believe it. I've seen how good it works. You started, you'll complete it. I take you at your word. You spoke in the chaos fell. I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on it. It's a narrow road, the tide is high, but you parted the water. And amen. We thank you, Jesus, for the truth that's in your word. We thank you that we can call on you at any moment. You hear our cries, Lord. Church, there's power in his name, amen. So I encourage you even now just to call on the name of Jesus. Come on, just call on his name. Just begin to speak his name over every situation, every circumstance. Jesus, we put our trust in you. We put our hope in you, Lord. We know that you are more than able to break every stronghold, to set the captives free. Give you glory, Lord. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life.
Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows.
Burn like a fire. Come on, call on his name. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold. Shine through the shadows. Burn dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Come on, in one voice, we speak his name. Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. Come on, I know there's some of you in this place that need to hear it. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over your minds, over fear and all anxiety. In Jesus' name, to every soul held captive, I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name, Lord,
your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life.
In your name, Lord, break every stronghold.
Break every stronghold.
Shine through the shadows.
Burn light.
Come on, there's power, church, when we together in one accord sing his name.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, and Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy.
Come on, speak it over your family.
Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak
the holy
name. Your name, Lord.
Jesus.
And we shout it out.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy.
speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I speak Jesus. We speak Jesus. We speak Jesus. Come on, church, just continue to say his name. That's the name that's above all names. The name that's above all names. Come on, I want you to call it out this morning. Whatever it is you're going through, if it's fear, call it by name. Recognize that Jesus is above it. Come on, if it's depression, call it out by name. Recognize that Jesus is higher. If it's healing in your body, call it out by name.
I speak Jesus.
Recognize that Jesus is more than able. Hallelujah. Come on, church, we need to respond to that word this morning. That's why our Jesus came. That's why he died. That's why he rose again, so that we could have life and life to the fullest. So whatever is holding you back this morning, it's time to let go. It's time to give it up to God. Say, Jesus, have your way. So shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy.
Every enemy.
Jesus for my family, I speak
the whole
your name, Jesus.
Jesus.
Come on, let it go this morning and let God, hallelujah. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness, over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name. Jesus.
Come on, we're gonna let the whole neighborhood hear us this morning. Lift up his name.
Shout Jesus from the mountains. Jesus in the streets. Jesus in the darkness, over every
Church, we know the fire provides light. How many of you need the Lord, need the Holy Spirit to help you find your way this morning? Come on, if that's you, just say his name, Jesus. We know that fire is power. It's fuel, church. Come on, if you need a touch from the Lord, if you need that Holy Spirit fire this morning, call out to him. We know that fire purifies. If there's any area, Lord, in our lives that needs your touch, that needs your purification, your sanctification, Lord, give us your strength to follow hard after you. Jesus.
Yeah.
be shaken. For your presence here in this place. We thank you that you hear our cries. We thank you for abiding here with us, Lord. We thank you for never leaving or forsaking. We have purpose in our hearts this morning to seek you first, Lord. Seek your kingdom, and we will take you at your word, which says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you. Church, it doesn't say some of these things, it says all of these things. Come on, all of these things will be added unto you. That means whatever you lack, know that in him you find your fulfillment. You find your provision. So Lord, again, we do lift up the needs of this body to you with full confidence, full assurance. We pray for those that need healing this morning in their physical bodies. We lift up our sister Linda. God, be her strength. Continue to be her strength. Wherever she's at this morning, may she feel your supernatural touch. Fill that room, Lord. Fill that room, Jesus. Holy Spirit, fill that room. We lift up our brother Mike Rodriguez to you as well, Father God. We pray continued healing on that knee. Strengthen that knee in Jesus' name. Touch any other part of his body this morning, Father God. Holy Spirit, continue to surround him. Be his strength, be his peace, be his help. Lord, we lift up any other who's struggling in their bodies. Just feel to lift up a prayer for those that are struggling with their allergies this season. Come on, our Jesus said that all these things will be added. Allergy sufferers, in Jesus' name. Come on, we pray that those air passages be opened, that those sinuses be cleared. In your name, Jesus. We pray for full breath. We pray for your breath to fill our lungs, Lord. In your name we pray. Jesus. One more time, let's just lift up his name. Hallelujah. As we sing this last verse.
Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
One last praise, Jesus, you're worthy. Hallelujah. Why don't you go around the room, welcome each other into God's house this morning.
Good morning. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Who's glad to be in the Lord's house today? Hallelujah. I was so glad to see you here this morning. My name is Rose. I lead the women's ministry here at Holland First, and it is a joy to see you in the Lord's house this morning. If this is your first time, we want to welcome you. We hope that you just feel at home in God's presence today among his people. And so if it is your first time, we have a special gift for you as you leave the service. There's a wall outside these doors called the Connection Center. And if you stop there, we have a gift for you. It is a special treat at the Isaac's Well House. You can stop there and get a coffee, you can get a smoothie, whatever you'd like. Husband would like a hot chocolate, so you can get that too. And we also have a gift for you of a coffee mug or a water, whatever you prefer. So let's welcome our first time guests. And whether this is your first time here or you have attended for years and years, go ahead and draw your attention to this. Go ahead and point your phone up there and scan the QR code. It lets us know who is here and who we should be looking for during the next couple of weeks just to pray for you and keep connected. It's so good to see you all here. And I'm going to ask that Pastor Ken come up and take God's tithes and your offerings. Let's welcome him as he comes.
Well, good morning. So celebrate with me. It's an anniversary for my wife and I. Oh, I'm sorry, not that kind. We've been here at Holland First for 13 months. Yeah. And they said it wouldn't last. I'm just saying. And one of the amazing things about this church family is that in those 13 months, every single person we've met has been so loving and so welcoming and so eager to embrace us and welcome us in. And I know that's because that's the kind of people we are here, right? We are people that are eager to follow after the Lord. We're people who are eager to extend fellowship and grace. And because I know that's the kind of people we are, I know we want that to be reflected in the way we give. Amen? Amen. So, back in another life, I owned an insurance agency for about 15 years. And in staff training, I would explain, okay, I want you to do this way. My way was always my way, which meant it was right. Amen, honey? Yeah? Sure, my wife says it must be so. So when I would say I want this done this way, whatever I would expect, I would inspect. So I would pull out random files and say, was this done my way, the way I wanted it done? I would inspect what I would expect. I thought about that and I thought, isn't that how I want it to be with my giving, the way I live before the Lord? I want to inspect in my life what I expect in my life. So how in the world would I inspect my giving? And then it occurred to me, I pull out my phone and I open up the app for my bank account and I look at the transactions listed there. Because as Pastor Mike said last week, where your heart is, your treasure will be also. So where is my treasure going? Because wherever my treasure is going, that's where my heart is. I can say my heart is here, but if most of my money's going to my boat, which I don't have, and I'd love to be on one, if anybody's going out this afternoon, just as a gentle hint, if I say my heart is here, but my money's in my landscaping, if I say my heart is here, but my money's in buying a new part for my hot rod car, if I say my heart is here, but my money is going to everything else, but not really being prioritized to the Lord's work, then where is my heart? When I inspect what I expect, I find that I'm not living up to my expectations. I want to. I know you do too. So I just invite you that as you're preparing to bring your tithe and your offering, that maybe you set an appointment for yourself to inspect what you expect, to go through that bank transaction list and find out, is my money being invested where my heart is? Amen? Amen. So I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward. You can give through the ushers here. If you brought cash, check. If you brought a credit card, you can throw that in. We'll make good use of that and give it back whenever we're done. If you have that sort of a digital means, you can do that online. We have an app online. You can scan the code and go to the app. You can do it at the kiosk out in the lobby. But look carefully. Inspect what you expect. If you expect great things from the Lord, He expects great things from you. Amen? Father, we are so, so, so grateful to have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. We are new in Christ. And as His possessions, as the residents of His Holy Spirit that lives within us, we want to present ourselves right now as living offerings. We want to present all that we have been given by You as an offering unto You as well. And specifically now, God, we return Your tithe and our offerings in the precious name of Jesus. And all of God's children said, amen, amen. Would you direct your attention to the feed?
Good morning, Holland First family and friends. Thank you for joining us today. Here's a look at some upcoming events. Our all-church cleanup day is happening next Saturday, April 13th. Together we can get our church and building grounds looking great for the upcoming summer. Lunch will be provided. If you're not able to stay for the entire time, no problem. Just come and help for the time that you can. If you do plan to attend, please sign up on our events page to ensure that we have enough food for everyone. Our new spring electives start this Wednesday. The new ladies class will explore the powerful stories of women throughout the Word who exemplified strength, hope, and trust in God, led by Pam Fuller. Pastor Mike and Amy Hauser will be leading a marriage class titled House or Home, God's Blueprint for a Great Marriage, based on the book by Chip Ingram. And Pastor Ken Stoltz will be leading a co-ed class that will take you on a journey through the books of Ezra and Nehemiah. For more details, please see your bulletin and visit the events page. Holland First Youth, get ready for a worship night at New Beginnings Assembly of God on April 17th. You will meet here at the church to drive out together. The cost is free, and be sure to bring a friend. The Men's Conference Invincible is happening on April 19th and 20th. The guest speakers this year are Wayne Francis and Chris Estrada. Go to the events page to sign up and get the important details about transportation and lodging. Moms with children ages birth to fifth grade are invited to the spring session of Moms of Grace. Beginning Saturday, April 20th from 9 o'clock to 10:30 a.m., moms will join together with Pastor Jennifer for snacks, fellowship, a short devotional on motherhood, and a prayer time for our children. Go to the events page to sign up so Pastor Jen can plan for you and your children. Our next child dedication is on Sunday, April 21st during the 11 o'clock service. If you'd like to have your child dedicated to the Lord, sign up online under events and email a picture of your child along with their full name to Kim Block no later than Wednesday, April 17th. See your bulletin for more information. We are replacing all ministry volunteer shirts with the same shirt that we use for the Serve ministry to achieve a more uniform look. If you're not currently a volunteer and would like to purchase a t-shirt just to wear and get our name out into the community, they're available for purchase for that as well. The cost of the shirt is $18 each for all sizes, and you can order as many as you would like. Please visit the events page to get all the details and to order. Get ready for the launch of the Holland First Español Life Group, led by the De Leons and the Valencias. They will meet every second Sunday at the home of the De Leons and every fourth Sunday here at Holland First. This is the final week that we will have the table in the narthex for the envelope fundraiser, so please return any envelopes taken previously or this week as soon as possible. Thanks. That's all for this week's announcements. A friendly reminder to please silence all cell phones during the service. God bless and have a great week.
Happens on the maestro. All right, come on and stand up this morning. Hallelujah. God's good. And all the time. How many would say this week you've had a tough week? Lift your hand. That's why sometimes we come into this place, and if you see me doing this a lot today, it's because I forgot my belt. It's not because I lost weight per se, but I might as well admit it. I mean, because first service I was constantly going like this, but I just feel led to say today, God understands what you're going through. He cares about you, and if you're down and you're discouraged, He wants to lift you up. He wants to lift you up. He wants to do it today through His Word. I just think, as we get into the series today, do want to just highlight just a couple of real quick things and do some announcements here. First of all, you saw on the slides today, or the feed, that there was a youth thing coming up in 2 weeks, a week from this Wednesday. They have canceled that. It wasn't Pastor Logan's fault at all. So, I mean, everything usually is the youth pastor's fault, but this was not. So, no, I'm kidding. Anyhow, I guess the church that was having it, they had some things happen where they can't. And so Pastor Logan wanted me to tell you that not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday, you will have a worship night, or excuse me, you will have a regular Holland First youth service. Invite your friends. There'll be fellowship and also a hangout. I don't have my glasses. It looked like it said haircut, but a fellowship and hangout. So there is that. Also, I want to announce that this Saturday, we could really use your help. I would say more so than most. We're doing a spring cleaning, and we've got a lot to do. We've got several of our closets that need to be emptied out. We even have a dumpster that's going to be put in the back. We just want to declutter. We also want to get some mulch down and some other things. So please do me a favor. Be here Sunday or Saturday. If this is your church, we could really use your help sprucing it up. And so we hope you'll come out. 9 o'clock, I think, Bill. Is that about when it starts? 9 o'clock. At 9 o'clock, go to 3, 4 o'clock. There'll be breakfast provided. There'll be lunch provided, so we hope that you'll come out. And then you also saw those t-shirts. I want to encourage everybody that calls Holland First home to purchase one of those t-shirts. Really do. It's a great way to be a light in our community. You know, I was going to do, a bumper sticker by Holland First, but the way I drive, nope, that was a bad idea. You know, so I should put in Getty on there or something like that and just fly or family church or whatever. Pastor Rose and Pastor, or my wife, are shaking their heads. No, bad idea. But see, I'm just trying. The joy of the Lord is your strength. It's your strength. So please order one of those shirts. We use it for various things, whether it's our events, but I would love for everyone to purchase that. Take your Bibles with me this morning and turn to Matthew's Gospel, chapter 4. I want to welcome home those that went away for spring break. Not all of them are back. Many of them are still on their way back. We had a wonderful first service, a great attendance here. But I know the Atwoods, you went away to Tennessee. I was envious of you. My son and Brenna went away to Florida, and they came back. They said it was 85 every day and sunny. And I said it was 35 every day and rainy. So anyhow, we welcome all of our spring breakers back. We missed you. And I want to start a new series today called Standing Strong in a Shifting World. How many would agree with me that this world seems to be shifting like crazy? The Bible says that everything that can be shaken is going to be shaken, so that what cannot be shaken will remain. So today, I want to first of all say that over these next few weeks, Lord willing, going to talk about different beliefs, not core values on the back wall, but different beliefs, core beliefs that we have to take to heart in order for us to continue to stand strong. Because I'm reminded of a scripture. It says that when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith on the earth? You know, that's a rhetorical question, but in a sense, it's not. We have to be able to answer that question. If that question is even being posed, that makes me think that the world's going to shift, and there's going to be a lot of Christians that just aren't going to be ready. I don't want to be one of them. I want to be ready. Amen? I know a lot of people have been talking about, especially on, and I'm going to get to the message, but people have been talking about the eclipse tomorrow. You know, and on a pastor site, everybody has a thing. It has nothing to do with prophecy. It has everything to do with prophecy. The red heifer, you know, recently, Passover, all these different things. And I came onto that site and I said, brothers and sisters, I don't care if it is prophetic or not. Let's just be ready. Let's just be ready. Let's not argue about whether this eclipse, even though there's eclipses that happen, what, every 18 months somewhere around the world or whatever, I don't know. Could it be something? Because the Bible does say there'll be signs in the heavens and in the earth below. But all I know is I want to be ready. Heaven is a prepared place for prepared people. No one gets there by accident, last time I checked. So we've got to be ready. So I want to talk about that, standing strong in a shifting world. I want to, first of all, take your word, if you have it with me, if you have it with you, if you have it on your phone or your app, you can just put it up in the air. This is what I want to talk about today. Go ahead, put that Bible or put that phone up. That Bible that you hold in your hand will stand the test of time. It'll stand the test of time. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. Some people get a little bit confused there and they say, well, Pastor Mike, if the heavens and earth pass away, what does that mean? The present heavens and the present earth will pass away. A new heavens and new earth is going to be made, and I plan on being a part of that. But until that time, we can take his word, which he honors above his name, and it can help us to stay strong in a shifting world. Everybody ready to close in prayer? Okay, I feel like I already preached. All right. Matthew chapter 4, starting at verse 1. You didn't get off that easy this morning. Verse 1, then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, afterward he was hungry. When the tempter came to him, he said, if you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Then the devil took Jesus up to the holy city, set him up on a pinnacle of the temple, and he said to him, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, even Satan knows the word, church, he shall give his angels charge over you. He used to be one of them until he fell and took a third with him. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. Jesus said to him, again, it is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. And then the devil tried a third time. He took him up to an exceedingly high mountain. He showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. And Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan. Sometimes we need to say that, away with you, Satan. For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. The devil was tired of getting his teeth knocked in, so he left, and behold, angels came and ministered to him. Thank you for the reading of your word. Change us by the word, we pray in Jesus' name. Everybody said, you may be seated this morning. Doesn't Mandy Bell do a good job on the piano? I said that in the first service. She does a great job. Amen. I think if we look this morning at this temptation, and this is very important that you hear it, Jesus did not begin his earthly ministry until he had his wilderness experience. Jesus, of course, was baptized in the River Jordan by John the Baptist in order to fulfill all righteousness. And then immediately, the Father speaks down. This is the Holy Spirit descended upon him as a dove. And then the Father said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. And then we know that right after that, he goes out into the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. He was there for 40 days and 40 nights. Now notice something. Satan did not come to him right at the start. It says he was there for 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was hungry. He was hungry. So notice what Satan tries to attack or tries to hone in on first. Satan would try to tempt Jesus with a desire. In this case, it was after what? 40 days of going without food. I have enough trouble, seriously, going without food one day. When I get ready to have a physical, I'm thinking, when will that physical be over so I can go to Logan's and get me some rolls? You know, I want to get it in now and then get it over with. But he's 40 days of fasting, so Jesus would have been exhausted after this 40 days of fasting. And here is the point. Satan would try to hit Jesus when he was most vulnerable. In church, that's when Jesus will try to hit you. Sometimes as a pastor, I face discouragement after a great Sunday service. I'm sure that our music pastor can attest because we do spiritual warfare. If you were here Wednesday night, he talked about how we need to have the heart of a warrior, Pastor Larry. It was a wonderful devotion. It was a beautiful time that we came together and we served the Lord in praise and in worship. But the first temptation, he comes to him with a desire of the flesh. If you're the Son of God, command that these stones become bread. Again, Jesus, I'm sure, was hungry, so it was kind of appealing to the flesh, in this case, his stomach. But notice what he says in verse 4. But Jesus answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. You see, he fought the devil and his own personal desire of food by knowing it was the word of God that would fill him up and enable him to be able to stand strong. Church, I'm here to tell you today, if you are in God's word on a regular basis, you are going to be able to stand strong. We're going to know those that are in his word and those that are out of his word. People will say, Pastor Mike, I just don't feel God anymore. And I realize you can still be in God's word and feel like the heavens are brass. But most of the time, if you're not feeling God, it's more than an emotion, it's a decision. But if you're not feeling God, I must ask you, how often are you in the word? It's how he speaks to you. It's how he talks to you. Second temptation, he comes to him with the pride of life. Notice verses 5 and 6. Then the devil, he took him to the holy city, Jerusalem. He set him on the pinnacle of the temple, and he said to Jesus, if you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge over you. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest your feet lest you dash your feet against a stone. Here is Jesus' response, verse 7. Jesus said to him, it is written again, you shall not tempt the Lord your God. You see, church, Jesus knew at this point in his life, it would be wrong for him to abuse his own powers. He didn't have to prove anything to Satan. Jesus had nothing to prove to Satan. Church, Satan is already defeated. When Jesus died and rose again, he took the keys from Satan of death, hell, and the grave, and he rendered him powerless. Powerless. Now, I realize this came before that, but Jesus was full of the Holy Spirit. Now, there's the third temptation, the lust of the eyes, verses 8 and 9. Again, third time, the devil took him up to an incredible, exceedingly high mountain. He showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their glory. And he said to him, all these things I will give you if you fall down and worship me. Notice Jesus' response in verse 10. Then Jesus, he was fed up. He was fed up. Then Jesus said to him, away with you, Satan. For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve. I feel led to say this morning, I'm not saying that we need to always be talking to the devil. We need to start talking to God more. But there's some times when you're facing discouragement. There are times when you feel like the heavens are brass. There are times when you feel like you're being sucker punched all the time from the devil. You need to in boldness say, away with you, Satan, for it is written, I'm going to worship the Lord my God, and him only am I going to serve. I'm going to serve him. Listen closely, church. If there ever was an occasion where Jesus, a quicker route to the Messiahship, it is right here what Satan said. Because we know that presently, Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 2 reminds us that the devil has control over the kingdoms of this world. Satan was ready to give them to Jesus in return for his allegiance. But the mere thought of that causes the Lord to shudder at such a concept. And he replies this time sharply, you shall worship the Lord your God, and with him only you shall serve. It was the word of God. If it was the word of God that enabled Jesus, the Son of God, who became the Son of Man, who would be tempted in every way, yet without sin, what do you think the word of God can do for you, my friend? What do you think the word of God, even right now, by the very amens, I'm not saying it's emotion, but it's good to show some, because when you're in his word, you know that it changes you. It changes you. I love preaching his word because it changes you. Jesus came out victorious, and so can you. You can come out victorious. Listen to this story. A few years ago, actually it's quite a few now, former FBI agent Joe Koenig published a book called Getting the Truth, I Am D.B. Cooper. He told a flight attendant that he had a bomb. He demanded $200,000 and four parachutes. When the plane landed in Seattle, authorities delivered the money and the parachutes. Cooper released the other passengers, let him go, but he ordered the plane to take off again. And somewhere over southwestern Washington, he parachuted out of the plane with that $200,000 and was never seen again. 9 years later, almost $6,000 of the ransom money was discovered along the banks of the Columbia River. And though the FBI investigated it for 45 years, no trace of the man known as D.B. Cooper has been found. Yet his notoriety endures. Today, you can listen to a lot of podcasts dedicated to this case. Understandably, Joe Koenig's book caused quite a stir. Based on years of investigation, Koenig identified a Detroit man named Walter Recca as the real D.B. Cooper. His book is fascinating and presents a compelling case for its claims. Yet it's nothing more than a diversion for an armchair detective and crime junkie. because there's little at stake in his claim. You see, Walter Recca died in 2014, so there's no one to punish and no justice to be handed out. Is Joe Koning's conclusion about Walter Recca reliable? There's not much rising on its trustworthiness, but here is why I shared this story. The Bible is anything but untrustworthy. It is transformational. The answers that are found in the Word of God provide you. They are important, but every person in the entire world, it's important to them because within the pages of God's Word, what is spoken is literally the difference between life and death. Just like Koning, he made a claim that he knew who D.B. Cooper was. Each of the claims that I'm about to give you this morning pose a powerful question. First, a statement, and then the question. God the Father is omniscient. He knows everything. Says who? After Jesus died on the cross, he rose from the dead. Says who? Everyone who believes in Jesus as Lord will one day have eternal life in heaven. Says who? And guess what? In each case, the answer is found in God's Word. Church, everything we know about God is found in this book. Everything. Everything we need to know about Satan and his schemes are found in this book. Everything we need to know about how to stand strong in a shifting world, it is found in this book. Church, if taken to heart and then applied to your life, the Bible will change your life forever. The book of James said, if you just hear the word, but you don't put it into practice, you deceive yourself. It's like a man looking at his natural face in a mirror and then walking away and forgetting what he looked like. It's not just about knowing the word, it's practicing the word. Every time you get depressed, start quoting the Word of God. Every time you're afraid, start quoting the Word of God. Every time you need wisdom, start quoting the Word of God. Every time you need answers, start quoting the Word of God. Every time you need power, start quoting the Word of God. Get it in you, it'll come out of you. Hallelujah. So number one, if you're taking notes, the Word of God is 100% trustworthy. I love it how you flip it backwards. It's worthy of our trust. It's worthy of our trust. Even as a pastor, there are times when I have questions from God's word. Not that I doubt his word, but there are times I have questions that I need God to shed some light on. There's some things I have to research from God's word to help me with something that might be concerning me in my present situation. My point is, there may be people out there today that are wondering, and who knows, some of them might even be in this room or watching online, or if you share this with an agnostic or an atheist or whatever, and they will say something like this: what proof is out there that the events in the Bible actually happened? If I'm going to believe the Bible, I want to see proof. You can't just, they'll say things like, you just can't spout off a quick answer. You've got to be able to dig deep because God's word makes unique, you know, statements. And what sets it apart from every other book that is out there? I mean, how is the Word of God different from the Book of Mormon? How is the Word of God different than the Quran? They both claim to be the Word of God. Let me give you three ways or three reasons that we can trust God's Word. The first one is God's Word is 100% inspired. It's inspired. The great inventor, Thomas Edison, he had a lot of failures, but he had a lot of successes. The great Tom Edison was known for his inventions such as the phonograph, the camera, and the incandescent lamp. He said this, genius, because some people would call him a genius. Genius is 1% inspirational and 99 cent perspiration. Means you got to work at it. Boy, you guys are a hard crowd. You got to work at it. Some of you just didn't get it. But the Apostle Peter, wow, said in 2 Peter chapter 2, 1, that God's word is inspired. He says this, but there were also false prophets among the people, even as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord who bought them, and bring on themselves swift destruction. Church, listen to this statement. Heresy and error, whether in belief or in practice, it begins to rise up in the church when Christians start to stray away from the pure teachings that are found in God's word. We get ourselves in trouble when we get away from the teachings that are found in God's word. Now, I know you already know that it's out there, but there are people today that are preaching untruths. Can I say, I said this to the first group this morning, some of you are actually going to count how many times I pull my pants up, but it's okay. 22 right now, 22, okay. You made me lose my train of thought. You really did. But you stop for a moment. And I felt God tell me to say this in the first service. If Holland First is your home church, you have zero reason to be a Bible illiterate. Because the Word of God is taught here. But you've got to take it to heart. There'll be no excuse for us when Jesus returns if we don't make it. Because I'll preach from the table of contents to the maps. But you've got to take it to heart. But I want you to watch this today, and the quality of it, the sound quality is not the greatest. You will know most of these pastors, but these are some teachings that are out there today. Listen to these.
If horses get together, they produce what? And if dogs get together, they produce what? If cats get together, they produce what? Godhead gets together and say, let us make man, then what are they producing? They're producing gods. Now, I got to hit this thing real hard in the very beginning because I ain't got time to go through all this, but I'm going to say to you right now, you are gods, little g. You are gods because you came from God, and you are gods. You're not just human. The only human part about you is this physical body that you live in.
As a pastor's like, so what do you think about gay men? I don't know why he decided to do it like this. I don't know why you're wrestling like that, and I don't know what to do to help you but to stand with you and pray with you and you're welcome at Transformation Church. Trans is in the title. Transformation, you can be here.
I should probably add this. When you get it wrong, don't quit. Clean up your mess and try again. This may sound strange to you, but in our school of ministry, our students are actually required to get it wrong. If they don't fail at least three times in the first year, we won't let them in the second year. Why? If you're not willing to take risk to the point where you get it wrong, you probably won't get it right in the way you need to. But secondly, we want you to get it wrong in a loving environment so you know how to clean up your mess.
You know, church, when I hear those things as a pastor, it's upsetting. To know that a pastor would say that we are small gods. I am not a small god. I am constantly in need of a savior. The second one, that was Creflo Dollar. The second one was Mike Todd. He's a fantastic preacher. He pastors Tulsa, Oklahoma's Transformation Church. Did you hear him say, talking about trans, he said trans is in the title of our church, Transformation? Church, that's scary. I would be happy to hear that there really was transformation, But he says, I don't know why God does it like he does. What? God has spoken in his word what is true and what is wrong, what's to be done and what's to be avoided. Bill Johnson was the last one you saw from Redding, California. He is the pastor of Bethel Church, where we get Bethel worship. And you might say, well, everything he sounded, Pastor Mike, give me some context. He was literally saying when you prophesy or you have a word of knowledge or message in tongues, he wants you to mess up at least 2 or 3 times. So that if you mess up in a good environment, people will be there to help you. Church, if I am used in a message in tongues, yes, we can make mistakes, but I'm not striving to fail. I'm striving to hear what the Holy Spirit has spoken so that it can come out into people's life. Are you hearing me today? Yes. I mean, you heard those people shouting that preacher down, and he's preaching that kind of stuff. And I'm preaching truth today, and it's hard to even get an amen. Amen. Just being honest. We've got to preach the truth today. Right. Today we have accommodation theology. I know, church, I'm one of the most unpopular pastors in Holland. I'm one of the most, I'll take the trophy. Give it to me. Because I'll lay it at the feet of Jesus when I see him someday. Church, I don't want to be popular. I want to be known in heaven. It's not going to be the size of the church. Jesus is simply going to look at me and say, were you faithful with the assignment that I gave you? Today we have accommodating theology, meaning, you know, because this is going on in our world, let's kind of accommodate them. Because this is kind of going in our world today, let's accommodate them. No. In fact, Pastor Michael Todd, that guy, he said this. People ask me all the time, what do you think about gay marriage? And that pastor says, I don't know. Really? Do you know anything about God's word? Because God's word talks about it. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. Sobering, isn't it, church? Sobering. 2 Timothy 3:16, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. The second one, B, God's word is 100% unified. I remember when I was in high school in biology class, my teacher, I started to say professor, that was in Bible college, but my teacher would say, I need you to, or no, he wouldn't. I'd want to get into groups of four, but he would pick different groups of four. And I'm thinking, I don't want you to pick for me, because if you pick 3 schlep rocks, I'm probably going to have to do all the work. So what would happen is if he'd say, now I want you to get into groups of four, immediately I would jump up and I would go to the 3 smartest people in the class and say, can I be in your group? Why? Because if you are the one that's with a bunch of schlep rocks, you're going to have to do all the work, because if you don't do all the work, you're all going to fail. You're all going to get F's. You say, Pastor Mike, where are you going with this? The Bible is the most historic thing. There's 40 authors that span all across the world. Before the invention of the internet, over the span of 1,500 years, it was a group project. How do you think that group project turned out? But the Bible is the most successful group project in history. And why? Because it was directed and orchestrated by God himself. In fact, in the Pentateuch, the first 5 books of the Old Testament was written by Moses. It took place in 1440 BC. Now fast forward to John the Beloved on the Isle of Patmos. He writes the book of Revelation around AD 95, so about 1,500 years. Listen, the 40-some people who recorded and composed God's message came from a very diverse group of people. Moses was a political leader. David was a shepherd before he became a king. Solomon was a king. Luke was a doctor. Paul was a rabbi. Peter was a He was a fisherman. They each had their own personality. They had their own perspectives in the world. These writers composed the Bible in a variety of different locations, spread across some 2,000 miles from Babylon to Jerusalem to Rome. The writers didn't stick to one literary style. Some wrote history. Some wrote law. Some wrote poetry. Some wrote allegory. Some wrote biography. Some wrote personal correspondence. Some wrote prophecy. Some even wrote apocalyptic literature. So many moving pieces, so many variables factoring into its creation, but the reason for its unity in a book that was composed under such a variety of circumstances is because a divine author oversaw the final project. He oversaw it all. See, God's word is 100% inerrant. That means it's without errors. Hear me right at the start of this. If we think the Bible contains mistakes, everything else becomes relative, and we begin to do what is right in our very own eyes. In recent years, critics have argued that the Bible doesn't claim to be the inerrant word of God. I just said it, 2 Timothy 3:16. They suggest that the modern era fundamentalist group came up with the concept of inerrancy as a way of promoting conservatism. Give me a break. The Bible, on the other hand, makes a totally different claim. Hundreds of Old Testament passages. We could be here till 6 o'clock tonight. Don't worry, you won't be. Hundreds of Old Testament passages that contain a variation of the phrase, "The Lord said." Exodus 20, verse 1, "And God spoke all these words, saying," Isaiah 1, 2, "Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken." Let me skip to Psalms 95, verse 7, "For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and we are the sheep of his hand. Today, if you will hear his voice." No one thought they knew the author of Psalms 95. Most of them were written by Moses, David, sons of Korah, and so forth. And people would say the author of Psalms is unknown, but you need to catch it. 2,000 years later, the writer of the letter of Hebrews in the New Testament identified the author of Psalms 95 as the Holy Spirit. Because listen, he repeats it, Hebrews 3:7. "Therefore, as the Holy Spirit says today, if you will hear his voice." Jesus himself affirmed the Genesis account of creation, and he gave God's blueprint for marriage. It's found way back in Genesis, and he talks about it in Matthew 19. Let's look at it. "And he answered and said to them, have you not read that he who made them at the beginning," made them male and female. Boy, that's come under scrutiny. I just recently tried to get my passport for the Dominican Republic, and it says, "What was your sex at birth?" So last time I checked, I'm still male. I'm sorry, church. It's just crazy. Okay, Matthew 19, 4 to 6. "And he answered and said to them, have you not read? He made them male and female. And he said, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his," "his wife. And the two shall become one flesh. So then, they are no longer two but one flesh. Therefore, what God has joined together, let man not separate." Amen. You can't even watch a Hallmark today without this coming under fire. We're watching Hallmark the other day, and all of a sudden, two dudes start making out. I'm like, what? How about when Jesus gave the story of Jonah to illustrate his resurrection? Matthew 12, 39 and 40. "But he answered and said to them, an evil and adulterous generation," what? "They seek after a sign. Unless I have a sign, I'm not going to believe. No sign is going to be given you except for the sign of the prophet Jonah." What was it? "For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth." One more. How about when Jesus linked his coming with Noah's building of the ark? Matthew 24, verse 37. But as the days of Noah were, so also will be the coming of the Son of Man be. It means that it's going to happen quickly. For as in the days of before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage until the day that Noah entered the ark and did not know. What do you mean they didn't know? He built the ark for 75 years and they didn't know? They weren't listening. They weren't listening. He says, God's so fed up, he's going to start over. Why do you think they call it the ark of safety? When we come to Jesus, he is our ark of safety. And what happens is the door closed, and they did not know until the flood came and took them all away. So also will the coming of the Son of Man be. I didn't know. Guess what? Every person who's here today, you know. You know. Number two, still with the pastor? All right. The Word of God goes hand in hand with one. Kind of sounds like the same, but it's not. The Word of God can be 100% trusted today and into the future. Listen closely. Some will say the following. Even if we concede, skeptics, even if we concede that God inspired the Bible writers and he made sure their words were inerrant, we still can't say for sure that the Bible that we have today is trustworthy. Technically speaking, they'll say, the inspiration and the inerrancy apply only to the original manuscripts. The problem is those original manuscripts vanished long ago into the mist of history, as Pastor Robert Jeffers says it. The Bible we have today is a copy of a copy of a copy, and so on. Scribes and scholars throughout history translated the original manuscripts into various languages and with great undertaking reprinted them by hand, word by word. When the original manuscripts were lost, other scribes and scholars reprinted those copies and so on. But some will then ask, skeptics, did these copies maintain the inspiration? Did they maintain their inerrancy of the originals? Can we be sure that those that copied it didn't make a mistake? How do we actually know that the Bible that we have today in 2024 is reliable? Well, here we go. I'll break it down even more into question form. A, are the copies of God's word accurate? First, we have to consider the number of ancient manuscripts of both the Old and the New Testament, which are available to us. Listen to this. This is not even Bible here. Most ancient literary works of antiquity have very few manuscripts to support their authenticity. There are only 7 manuscripts of Plato. There's only 10 manuscripts of Caesar's Gallic Wars. You know, the Celts versus the Romans and then the rise of the Roman Empire. There's only 10 manuscripts. And there's 20 for the historian Tacitus. But for the Old Testament alone, there are over 10,000 manuscripts. The most significant one, the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were discovered by a Bedouin herdsman in 1947. Stay with me. The scrolls were sealed in clay jars and hidden in a cave. Written about 100 BC, they include a complete copy of the book of Isaiah and fragments of almost every other book in the entire Old Testament. Before the scrolls were discovered, when? 1947, the oldest copy of the Old Testament was dated around AD 900, 9 years before Christ. Nearly 1,000 years after the Dead Sea Scrolls were written. The discovery of the Dead Sea Scroll gave all the scholars and all the skeptics an opportunity to compare the copies of the Old Testament that have been created nearly 1,000 years apart. Let me give you an illustration. I used to do this when I was a youth pastor. We would start in a big circle, and I would give a scenario about the destructive power of rumors and gossip. And I would give kind of a lengthy thing into someone's ear, and then they would share it, and then they would share it, and then they would share it. It would go all the way around the room. And by the time it got to the last person, do you think it was an accurate rumor? Do you think it was an accurate gossip? It had been so watered down. It had been so taken out of context, sometimes it wasn't even close to what I originally had said. Pastor Mike, what is your point? Glad you ask. The scrolls, listen to this. This is so awesome. When they discovered the Dead Sea Scrolls, it set the stage for scholars to see how the words of Isaiah had changed. Perhaps they're even unrecognizable over those 1,000 years. The circumstances were ripe for skeptics to be able to say, see, I told you the Bible is unreliable, but here was the result. The scrolls testified to the painstaking accuracy of each of the copyists. Scholars discovered that 95% of the words, they were, what about the five? I'll get there, okay? 95% of the words in the text written in AD 900 matched their counterparts in 100 BC. Think about that. For example, Isaiah 53. This is so powerful. Scholars found only 17 letters in question. I did not say word, I said letters. 10 of those were simply spelling differences. 4 letters were related to minor issues like conjunctions. You need to put a comma before but, sometimes before and. The only one questionable word, if you look in the NIV, it does not alter in any significant way the meaning of the text. It spells the word light, which is found in Isaiah 53, verse 11. Only one word in question after 1,000 years of copying 166 words, only one word was in question. Church, think about that this morning. Go to the New Testament. The manuscript supports the New Testament even more overwhelming. The books of the New Testament, without a doubt, were the most frequently copied books of any books in antiquity. Listen to this. Today, we have nearly 25,000 copies or portions of the New Testament. There is more manuscripts supporting Jesus Christ in the Gospels alone of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John than any other figure in the ancient world, including Julius Caesar and Alexander the Great. But that doesn't stop teachers from teaching about those two people in history, does it? The amount of time between the original books of the New Testament and the earliest existing copies is only a couple hundred years. Here it is. It sounds like a long time, but the oldest manuscripts of the most classical Greek authors are dated more than 1,000 years after the author's death. Church, I'm giving you knowledge today that you can take the word into your life. It is trustworthy. B, are the right books in God's word? I've had people come up to me very recently and say, the Bible's missing a few books. No, it's not. No, it's not. It's not missing anything. God didn't announce, church, this is just the band. They're not going up in the rapture. They will someday. Just trying to, they got to go to the band here. God did not announce he was creating an Old Testament and then recruit authors to write books, each 1 to 39. He didn't announce that, to Moses, hey, I want to do a 5-book deal with you. I'll give you a couple grand, five-book deal, like a publishing company does, you know, for well-known evangelists today. He didn't go up to Nehemiah and say, I'm going to slot you between Ezra and, let's say, Esther. He didn't reject the first drafts from Obadiah and Nahum for being too long, like me, in preaching, and say, I already have enough major prophets. What I need is some minor prophets. Same into the New Testament. The gospel writers of the New Testament weren't trying to get their biographies attached to the Old Testament. Paul, Peter, and John never stopped in the middle of writing and asked, how can I put this more biblically? The authors didn't know they were writing the Bible. In fact, the Bible as we know it, the canon, 39 books in the Old Testament, 27 books in the New Testament, didn't exist until the Bible readers were dead. The uniqueness of God's word extends to the way that it was compiled. Most of the Old Testament books were recognized as God's word as soon as they were written. The book of Moses, which is called the Pentateuch, was immediately placed in the Ark of the Covenant to remind Israelites of its importance. The first Greek translation of the Old Testament is known as the what? Septuagint. The first Greek translation of the Old Testament is known as Septuagint. It was written between 250 and 150. It contains every book in the Old Testament, which means the Old Testament canon was complete by at least 150 years before Christ came into this earth in the form of a baby. Jesus later would affirm the completeness of the Old Testament by his reverence for the word of Almighty God. Church, what I am saying it is this. Is this a history lesson? Yes, it's a Bible history lesson. It is priceless, and it's why I am starting this as my first message in the series. The Bible is our firm foundation in a world that seems to be shifting out of control all the time. We need to stay in God's word. The Bible falling apart belongs to one who is not. Get into his word and be strong in the power of his might. Now, church, if I can have that energy preaching twice and playing the drums twice, come on, you can stand to your feet and give God praise today. You can take him at his word. You can take him at his word. Hallelujah, Jesus. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Just remain standing. Just remain standing. Oh. There is nothing I love more, Pastor Ken, than preaching the word of God. Nothing. Just like how you love to teach, I love to preach. What does this mean for us today? Number three, what does this mean for us today? Here it is. If the word of God is inspired, it's unified, it's inerrant, it's canonized, it's complete, it still doesn't do it justice what I've been preaching today. This is just a snapshot. Can I say God's word heals? God's word heals. God's word healed my emotions when I was going through a dark time. Pastor Chris, former pastor, some of you know this story. He was burned. 2/3 of his body were burned. They told him he would not make it. They went to his wife and said, Pastor Chris, he will die. He will not make it. She refused to believe that. She got out the word of God and started reading the word to him. And every day, getting the word in him. And he is living proof that God's word heals. He went on to pastor Trinity for 23 years, and he's still alive today at 90 some years of age. Don't tell me that God's word doesn't heal. It'll heal you if you get it in you. B, God's word guides. It guides. James says, if you lack wisdom, ask. He doesn't make you feel dumb. You know, your parents, hopefully, when you come up to them and ask them a question, unless it's one you've asked a million times. But chances are, if you come to them with an honest to goodness question, they're going to be like, hey, let me see if I can help you with that. God says, if you lack wisdom, come to me. I'll give it to you. And I won't find fault with you. He'll guide you. I love this. Psalms 119, 105. Your word is a lamp to my feet, and it's a light unto my path. Church, what is the Bible? B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand upon the word of God, the B-I-B-L-E. Bible! As Perla is yawning in the front row. I'm kidding with you. I'm joking with you. She's like, what happened? Can I give you an acrostic for the word? I still love you, Pearl. I hope you still love me. I was just having fun. Bible, B-I-B-L-E. Basic instructions before leaving earth. Know it. Know it. Know his word. And last one, God's word inspires. I remember, Logan, you take this. I don't give everybody hope that this thing's about done. 12:36. All right, thank you, brother. When I was just a little kid, I accepted Jesus as Lord down at the altar of Dayton Bethel Temple at probably 5 or 6 years of age. 12 or 13 years of age, I went to a Bible camp at Big Prairie Camp in Ohio. Did not know my wife was there. All those years, it was such a big camp, we never met. But I remember being called to the ministry in eighth grade, filled with this Holy Spirit. I began to love his word, and now I'm 54. I'll be 55 years of age next month. I became your pastor when I was 38. I'm almost 55. And can I tell you what I have concluded after 55 years of living? If you'll allow God's word, it'll transform your life. It'll transform every part of your life. It'll help you walk in straight in a world that has scissors and all types of different paths you can take. It'll keep you on the narrow path that leads to eternal life. I want to ask today, no heads bowed, no eyes closed. Would there be anybody here today, you'd say, I need a God like that. I want to give my life to him. If he did all of that work, his love letter to us, his word. You know how you love it, woman, a woman loves it when her man writes to her? Oh, man. It's awesome. God's word was his love story to us. Is there anybody? I don't know. Maybe we're all Christians. Over the last weekend, we had 11 people give their life to Christ. 11. That's awesome. And maybe there's one here today. Maybe there's one here today that says, I'd like to give my life to the one who you've been talking about today. Would you just lift your hand? I'll give an opportunity here. Just want to make sure. Chris is just praising the Lord. He's saved. He's saved, yes. Anybody here? Seriously, just lift it up. Okay, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to pray over you. And I would just love for us to go out with a shout of praise. In fact, you know what I want to do? You're on drums. Awesome. That is great. Look at that. He's awake on the platform there. I want to do take you at your word. I got to ask you something, Pastor Larry. Did you know I was preaching about the word? You did not. Did you know I would preach about the word probably? Okay. He said I would preach the word, but he had no idea that I'd be preaching a part one message about God's word will stand the test of time. But we sang today in our second song, we can take him at his word. Whatever he has told you, he will be faithful to complete it. Whatever he has told you, if he said you're going to be healed, you're going to be healed. He will never waste your pain. If he said your children will be saved, then your children will be saved. If he said your marriage will come back together, I don't care how it looks, it will come back together because God is not a God that he should lie. So we're going to come to the altar today, or you can leave today, whatever you feel led, but I just want to pray this prayer. There'll be elders and altar workers down here, but I want to pray this, and then we're just going to sing this song, and you can leave whenever you want. May the Lord bless you, and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you, and may the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his incredible shalom. Incredible peace to the praise and to the glory of his name in Jesus' name. And all together we said, praise the Lord. Come on, let's praise the Lord. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Go ahead, man.
But I wanna be on it. narrow road, the mercy's wide, 'cause you're good on your promise. Take you at your word, you said it, I'll believe it. I've seen how good it works. You started, you'll complete it. I take you at your word. Fell in line. 'Cause I know, 'cause I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on it. It's a narrow road, the tide is high, but you parted the water. Just full of your hope, you never fail, so why not?